Did the Fantastic Four really transcend dimensions? Or is Planet Zero less alien than we thought? Science behind the Fantastic Four. I know, not everyone liked 2015's Fantastic Four. In fact, doing the math, about 91% of people despised the movie. And the other 9%, I'm pretty sure they can at least admit the film had some pretty big issues. I'm one of those divided people. By no means was the actual story slash script good, but in my opinion, I did like character designs. Oddly enough, I loved how Dr. Doom looked. I actually wouldn't mind that cast returning for a good sequel, because personally, I think that cast is just a golden opportunity. That being said, I was thinking about the movie and I realized that there were a few things about it that actually did intrigue me. The most interesting place in the movie for me was Planet Zero, the movie's version of the Negative Zone from the comics. The reason I'm making this video on Planet Zero is because it is quite different from the Negative Zone. In the comics, the Negative Zone is actually explained, so it just wouldn't be up my alley. So, what is with Planet Zero? What is so special about it? Well, in the movie, Franklin Storm, the scientist who recruits his two kids and other young prodigies to aid in his studies, explains to the American government that one of his scientists, Reed Richards, has cracked interdimensional travel. And we can all guess what happens from there on out. They get their powers, Doom gets trapped on Planet Zero, they reunite to stop him, pretty basic stuff. But is Planet Zero really another dimension? In short, no. See, fictional media tends to warp the definition of a dimension a lot. Take Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, for instance. I love the new movies, and I always love the old show, but I only recently realized that Dimension X, where one of the main villains was from, likely isn't even a dimension. In fictional media, dimensions are often portrayed as separate realities or universes, and while that is mostly correct, there's one inconsistency that contradicts what we theorize scientifically. The way dimensions work is similar to the idea of 2D and 3D, that's why we call them that. For instance, 3D means three-dimensional. But what does that even mean? Well, look at it like this. Imagine three bubbles. Ignore what's outside those bubbles because I'll jump to that in a bit. Now, these three bubbles are dimensions. The first bubble is the first dimension, the second bubble is the second dimension, and the third bubble is the third dimension, which is the dimension that our reality resides in. In the third dimension, things can rotate, giving them their three dimensions, which are height, width, and depth. That's why a 3D movie at theaters pops out so much. They are given the illusion that they have those dimensions to them. Now, the second bubble, the second dimension, would be a step down from our own, theoretically. The second dimension, if it did contain life, would contain beings in environments that have only width and height. To show you a little better, try drawing just a stick figure on a piece of paper. No matter how you draw that figure, it cannot rotate because it has no depth. Only width and height exist for that character. Only left, right, up, and down exist on that paper. Essentially, you could use that paper as an example of what the second dimension might look a little like. Another good example is this. Pretend for a second that you are a being from the second dimension. Now, in the third dimension, when I roll a ball towards you, you can see that ball rolling against the floor and perceive it as physically getting closer. However, if you are a being from the second dimension, all you would see is the outline of a circle expanding. You wouldn't even perceive that it's approaching you. That's the second dimension in a nutshell. The first bubble, which is the first dimension, is so primitive that it actually needs a rather advanced understanding. I'll try my best to explain the idea of a one-dimensional form of existence. If any of you have ever drawn a line using a graph in math class, it looks a little something like this, right? For those who might not recognize this, basically the graph is what's called a plane. A plane, theoretically, exists and nothing else. And the plane, which is like an infinite flat surface, has nothing below it and nothing above it, and only one dimension. The plane expands, so it has length, but it carries no height or width or depth. Even the line that you draw as the plane is too thick to really accurately represent it, because I just don't think a plane would even be visible to the naked eye. In the first dimension, things like planes, points, and lines exist, but they take up absolutely no space. Now, that's a breakdown of the three bubbles. Let's jump back to Fantastic Four. In the movie, the Four are credited with cracking interdimensional travel, meaning they found a way to transcend across these bubbles. But did they really find a way? I think it's safe to assume that if they did, the Four likely traveled to the fourth dimension, which will be our fourth new bubble. The reason I say this is because wherever they went definitely has three-dimensional aspects. The fourth dimension has properties of the third dimension, much like our third dimension has properties of the second dimension. Everything possible in our dimension is possible in the fourth dimension. But the fourth dimension would have another aspect to it that we wouldn't have. The fourth bubble would have width, height, and depth, but what is the other missing element? Well, it's hard to say because we've never truly observed it, and whether or not we ever will is unknown. It's likely that if a fourth dimension does exist, that we simply wouldn't be able to conceive of what other properties exist there. We as beings of the third dimension just wouldn't be able to mentally register something so vastly different from everyday life. Think of it like this. As beings from the third dimension, if we traveled to the second dimension, we'd likely see all the second dimensional people, or beings, and think, "Wow, they look like drawings, how weird. They have no depth and they can't rotate, how odd." But for the beings of the second dimension, they would probably just perceive us the same way they perceive each other, or they might not even see us at all. Because the concepts of depth and rotation simply do not exist in their dimension, they wouldn't be able to register those concepts, even when they're right in front of them. The same would go for us third-dimensional beings traveling to the fourth dimension. It would have properties of our native dimension, but it would be so vastly, vastly different that I doubt it would look anything like Planet Zero. Planet Zero, from what I see, exists within the third dimension. Some could argue that whatever form Sue takes on when she becomes invisible could be a fourth dimensional property, but I don't think it is, because we as beings of the third dimension do understand the idea of invisibility and translucency, which are the powers Sue possesses. Some could also argue that the properties of the fourth dimension just aren't seen in the movie because the characters, beings from our third dimension, don't conceive of it themselves. Well, I suppose this is possible, I just highly doubt it, because such new properties would shape an environment extremely different from ours. And when I say extremely, I mean unrecognizable. I can look at Planet Zero and deduct that it is probably from our dimension because it is so similar to it, and abides by all of its concepts. The only conclusion I can reach is that the scientific team was mistaken and that Planet Zero resides within our own dimension. So, if Planet Zero is in our own dimension, then what is it and where could we find it? Well, I've got a few theories as to what and where Planet Zero is. One idea that I had was that instead of transcending dimensions, it's possible that the Four transcended universes and ended up in a parallel universe. Now, the way that would work is they'd still be in their own bubble, the third dimension, but there are bubbles within those bubbles, and there are ones outside it, likely. The ones inside them are possibly infinite, and each of those is a universe. Basically, every dimension has its own multiverse, and it's possible that the Four merely transcended their own multiverse. It's also possible that the Four never even left the universe and were simply teleported to an alien planet. However, there's no solid evidence to support either of those, and neither can we explain how it would work. It's just speculation at that point. However, my third theory does have evidence to support it. Since we're talking about a comic book movie here, what if the Four didn't travel dimensions, nor universes, but Reed Richards had somehow cracked time travel? Now, that's a huge leap, but hear me out on it. While I can't quite explain time travel, I can explain where it might have taken them. My consensus is that where they ended up is exactly where the machine used to be, or will be in the present time. But that raises the question, did they travel forward or backward in time? Let's say they traveled forward in time, what would that mean for the future of Earth? Well, whatever energy exists on Planet Zero would have to be there for a reason, right? even if that energy exists in our Earth's very core, it didn't just spring up one day, so what caused it? Well, although it was pretty shoehorned in, Dr. Doom did have an agenda in this movie. Dr. Doom saw Earth as a threat to his new world and tried to merge the two into one. This gave me a pretty interesting notion. What if Planet Zero is a future Earth where Dr. Doom's plans succeeded and the Four were never able to stop him? Now, that itself would have honestly been really cool, but it's likely not the answer. The Four do end up stopping Doom, so it would have been impossible for them to travel to a world where that didn't happen, because it did happen. Keep in mind, we're talking about an Earth that used to be their own in their own universes. Paradoxes are interesting, but in this case, it just doesn't work. So, when is Planet Zero? I tossed around a few more ideas, and I came to a pretty startling conclusion. Look at the terrain of Planet Zero. How would you describe it? I would describe it as barren, without life, and monstrous, at least in regard to the weather. Several times in the film, we get a glimpse at the volcanic activity that takes place on Planet Zero, along with what might have been the results of high tectonic activity. And, like I mentioned, the flashes of lightning indicate extreme and inconsistent weather. To me, that all means one thing for Planet Zero. Wherever Planet Zero is, it was just born at the time the Fantastic Four arrive on it. See, while we've never witnessed the birth of a planet, we have an idea of what it looks like. Because the planet just came together, there's high tectonic activity, like earthquakes and volcanic eruptions, and the weather is out of control because it's still adjusting to the new planet. What else would be on a planet that was just born? Not life, that's for sure. On Planet Zero, there is no other life because the planet has had no time to let anything evolve. A new species could not be created under conditions of a new planet's violent terrain. So, what is it I'm getting at here? Well, I believe Planet Zero was quite possibly Earth in the making. I believe that somehow, when the Four cracked time travel, they brought themselves to what we call Primordial Earth. Primordial meaning basically the prehistory of prehistory, the very dawn of whatever we'd be referring to as primordial. An example of this that you may have heard of would be primordial tar, which some assume life came out of during the final stages of primordial Earth. But where's my proof? Well, take a look at these images of primordial Earth that were based off of scientific scrutiny. See something familiar? It looks, down to the dot, exactly like Planet Zero. This opens up a whole new spectrum as to what the outcome of the movie was. Yeah, to be honest, it was a pretty bad movie, but this kind of gives it a new light to me. So many other questions pop up because of this. What gave the Four their powers? Does that substance really exist? Is Dr. Doom responsible for major events that took place on Earth? Heck, it's even possible that Dr. Doom might have set evolution into motion during his time on Planet Zero. It's a long shot, but Doom had some pretty amazing powers. It's not too out there to imagine him creating the first bacteria from matter he found on Planet Zero. So, that's my theory on what Planet Zero is. I don't think the Four traveled dimensions, nor do I think they traveled universes. I believe that they traveled to the dawn of our existence itself. Not only that, but this is actually really fitting. You know why? Because it would mean that the Fantastic Four really were Marvel's first family. Hey guys, hope you all enjoyed the episode of Science Behind Superheroes. If you guys did, make sure to leave a like and leave a comment as to what superhero or supervillain you guys want to see me do in the future. I keep saying this like every video now, but this was really fun to make. This was a really awesome premise that I just thought up one day, and I didn't even have to do that much research because I kind of knew all the concepts that I talked about in this video. And just, the idea of Planet Zero being like that distant past Earth, and the mythology behind it was just so cool to me. Now that being said, guys, before we end off this video, I have a quick announcement to make. We are getting really close, as of the making this video, to 200 subscribers. We might even have 200 by the time this video is pumped out. So what I want to say is I was thinking about doing some kind of Q&A for 200 subscribers, and it would be kind of like you guys can either ask me questions about myself, or you can ask really brief questions that relate to the scientific superhero topic. And whatever those, they can be like, you know, what's your opinion on how maybe Green Goblin's glider work or something like that. Just something quick like that, you know what I mean? And, yeah, guys, that's the end of the video. Have a good day.